Dr. Anita, so we will be starting the class. It is 3:30. First of all, on behalf of SRCC Children's Hospital, managed by Narayan Health, I, Dr. Rasik Shah, Senior Pediatric Surgeon, welcome all delegates who are logged on to Zoom and majority is logged on to YouTube. Earlier, we were doing this masterclass on Microsoft Teams, but somehow we were not very happy with that. So we have shifted to Zoom. This time we had given address of YouTube live streaming. From next time, we will have both Zoom as well as YouTube live streaming. First 100 participants will be able to join on Zoom and the others will be able to join on YouTube. And those who are on Zoom, they will be able to interact with question answer directly at the end of the lecture. I think all of you know Dr. Anita Hegde. She is a senior pediatric neurologist in Mumbai, and she has huge experience of pediatric neurology as well as seizures in children. So we had first part last Wednesday, where we discussed about different types of seizures and how to diagnose that, as well as we discuss about febrile seizures. So this time it is going to be the treatment of seizures. Dr. Pooja Mehta is going to be there with us as a moderator. So whatever questions are there, you can either write on chat box if you are on Zoom, or on a conversation box or chat box on YouTube, and it will be passed on to Dr. Anita Hegde at the end of the class. The class will be approximately 45-50 minutes talk followed by question answer session. So I welcome you all once again, and we will start with the talk of Dr. Anita Hegde. Madam, please.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. We have a long session coming up ahead of us. We have a 40 minutes or a 45 minutes on the management of pediatric epilepsy. I have tried to cover the most practical aspects that we will, you would be interested in. I wish it was interactive, and I strongly recommend, I would be happy to answer all your questions, however small and simple they may be. So please put them on the chat as the talk goes by, because I'm covering lots of issues out here so that we can discuss it all at the end. So, the first, what we're gonna cover today is a long session. First, unprovoked seizure. Just to touch on what is an epileptic syndrome and is it necessary for us to classify them? What are the investigations we require? Which are the new drugs in the market? Treatment of new onset epilepsy. So when you say it's epilepsy and we start treating, how do I choose my first drug? How do I think and how do I choose newer versus older anti-epileptic agents? How do we start? How do we stop? If it's a difficult epilepsy, what to do, when to refer, whom to refer? And very important aspect is home management, which you should be teaching all your patients and their relatives before they leave your clinics. So the first thing is definitions to come in brief. What is a seizure or a convulsion or a fit? Okay, these are terminologies which are very loosely used and we need to understand each of them properly. So it's an acute clinical change due to an abnormal neurological discharge. We understand the brain is working on electrical currents. Any of these currents goes awry in the wrong direction, either due to something blocking it or some chemical which comes in the way, it leads to a seizure. Whereas epilepsy is a person who has a tendency to have seizures. The seizure is actually the event. A seizure, a convulsion, or a fit is the event that happens. Epilepsy is the tendency to have seizures. So when you have two or more unprovoked, means there's no underlying cause that you can identify, more than 24 hours apart, you call it an epileptic tendency. So what are situation related or acute symptomatic? When a seizure happens because it's provoked, either fever, infection, metabolic disturbances, trauma, head injury, toxic event, any of that, we call them acute symptomatic seizures, and or we call them situation related seizures. So seizure is unprovoked, it's non-febrile, It cannot be explained by any immediate, obvious provoking cause such as head injury or infection. They are usually focal or generalized. They can be focal into generalized, and usually they will be multiple with recovery of consciousness in more than 28 days. Myoclonic or atonic seizures. There are certain types of seizures we don't include because usually by the time the child presents to you, like absence seizures, you've all seen childhood absence seizures. You're never going to pick up the first absence seizure. It's going to be the teacher who's been noticing for many months or the mom who's been noticing for many days that a child is blanking out. By the time they reach the doctor, the child has already had multiple episodes. So that is not a seizure. Those are epilepsy. They are more than one unprovoked event. And epilepsy is two or more seizures without an acute provocation. So when you say provoked, what are these features that we talk about? So when you're acute symptomatic, the commonest provocation is fever, head injuries, hypoglycemia, hyperglycemia, hyponatremia, hypernatremia, brain infection, stroke, hemorrhage, drugs. So these people have a very minor risk of long-term epilepsy. The natural incidence of epilepsy is 3%, okay, in the general population. So if you have an acute symptomatic seizure, the chance of you becoming epileptic down the line is almost as low as the general population. 3 to a slightly higher, suppose you've had a stroke or a hemorrhage, you do realize, or an infection, you do realize you might end up with long-term, so the percentage goes up. But those who have epilepsy, pure epilepsy, which is unprovoked, what are the things that actually bring on seizures? Lack of sleep, severe psychological stress. When it says stress, extremes of emotion, very happy, very sad, very fearful, very anxious, very angry, any excessive emotions, fatigue, so exhaustion, infections. And obviously, if we have a family history of a genetic epilepsy, then so these are the people who are prone to epilepsy. These are the people who are prone to symptomatic seizures with only a 3% chance of it recurring. Those who are prone to epilepsy have a 50 to 70% chance of it recurring and coming again. So you can see the difference between the two. The first rule when a patient comes to you and a parent tells you that my child did something different, doctor, what is it? If you are not sure that it is a seizure or not, it is better to wait for a recurrence or a clarification before you label the child as epileptic or having a seizure. Okay, remember that if you have epilepsy, it is almost definitely going to come back again within the next 2 to 6 months. So if you are not sure, this movement that the child did, this early morning getting up and some abnormal thing, and you're not sure, and trust me, very often we are not sure as well, at that time, it's better to say, I'm not sure, I'm going to wait, because if it's an epilepsy, it will come back again. And when it comes back again, and then we've had 2 events or 3 events, then I'm a little more confident of labeling this as an epileptic phenomena. So I have to briefly, since we've got so much to go through, very briefly, first, unprovoked seizure. What do we do? These are the protocols we follow. The only thing you do after the first unprovoked seizure is an EEG. You do not need to do neuroimaging. You do not need to do lab tests. Yes, if you're less than 1 year of age, the picture may be different. If you're in that age group where hypocalcemia, hypomagnesemia, and electrolyte issues are a concern, then yes, you might do a few lab tests. But if it's totally unprovoked, out of the blue, no fever, no nothing, first seizure, the thing that you will do is an EEG, and you will wait. What are the factors which may think that the epilepsy will come and the second seizure might come is if the EEG is abnormal, if you've done a neuroimaging because the child has some abnormality, if the child is neurologically abnormal, he's got cerebral palsy, he's got other concerns, syndromic child, etc., you might do an imaging. And if you can identify the etiology, these are the predictors of recurrence. But ideally, after the first EEG, the only test we need to ask for is an EEG. But here, the EEG is very important. It's done and reported by a pediatric neurologist, done in a center which does children's EEGs, because children's EEGs are very, very different from adult EEGs. And what is the treatment of a first seizure? Majority of children with a first unprovoked seizure will not have another seizure. Only 10% will go on to have multiple seizures. Only 10%. and treatment after the first is opposed to the second has not been shown. So when you want to treat the first seizure, this is how I explain it to parents. After your first seizure, there's a 50-50 chance that you will get another seizure. It's like tossing a coin. You could either go this way or that way. So at the end of that first seizure, if you don't treat, the fear is, but doctor, what will happen? Will the second one be serious? Will my child go into the ICU? The chance of treating after the first seizure does not change the long-term picture of the epilepsy if you treat after the first or you treat after the second. It does not change the cognition. It does not change the intellect. It does not change the recurrence of seizures, and it does not change the long-term picture or response to seizures. And that is why with evidence-based medicine, we can hold on the first seizure unless there are very specific reasons. And you can wait till the second seizure before you start long-term treatment, because treatment is a minimum period of 2 years. So now you've covered unprovoked seizures, you've covered symptomatic seizures. We're coming to now this child has had more than 2 seizures and he's been diagnosed as epilepsy. So this is the classification of epilepsy. Today, you have focal seizures and generalized seizures. See, the word is seizures here. And then once you've had more than 2 of unknown etiologies, you'll go into focal or generalized, combined focal and generalized. And once you look at all the etiologies, the structure, the genetics, infections, metabolic, immune, unknown, we can club our children into epileptic syndromes. So what is a syndrome? I think it must have been covered with you prior, but when it presents at a certain age, either neonatal, infancy, childhood, or juvenile, it has a certain type of seizure. It's either focal or generalized each time. The type of seizure, if it's generalized, can be absence, myoclonic, atonic, or tonic. And then depending on the etiology, is it because of something? So it's called symptomatic. If there's an underlying pathology or etiology, it's symptomatic. Or if there isn't, very often now it is genetic. And then with the syndrome, I can tell you the long-term picture for this child. Will he recover or will he not? Will his EEG, will his cognition go down or will he not? Will he have academic problems or not? Which is the best drug for him? How long will he need to treat? All that information I can give you if I can diagnose which epileptic syndrome it is. So what do we need for this diagnosis of an epileptic syndrome? You need a good history, very important, age of onset. When did the seizure start? Not when the child is sitting in front of you, but when did it really start? What type was it when it started? What was the frequency when it started? How has it evolved over a period of time? Which medicines help the most? What is the child's development? Has the development regressed after the seizures? Has the development stayed the same? Is the child doing brilliantly in spite of the seizures? And is there any family history? A very important part of the history and your whole definition of how you treat and choose your drug is going to be on the type of the seizure. So focal means it's coming on one side of the body and it's coming because something is on the opposite side. Generalized means it's diffuse electrical activity of the brain, giving you either absence seizures, myoclonic seizures, GTCs, atonics, any of those. So focal seizures will be twitching of the mouth, twitching of the eyes. And very often what I do, as I'm doing just now with you, is I actually show the patient. Did his eyes go to one side first and twitch and then he started the seizure? Did it start with his mouth? Did it start? Ask them where it started. The start of the seizure will tell you what type of seizure it is. So you, mother will say, pura badan hila raha tha. And then you ask, ek side se, ha ha ha, ek side se chalu hua, aank ye side pe gaye, phir pure badan pe chalo. So it explains to you that it started as a focal seizure and went to a generalized. That will tell me which drug to choose down the line. The EEG is very important. It tells me the background. The background gives me an understanding of the cognitive and the intellectual and the brain development of the child. The discharges tell me whether they're few or they're frequent. They tell me where in the brain it is coming from. They tell me what type of epilepsy or syndrome I might be looking at. Imaging, on an average, the rule for all epilepsies, you would require neuroimaging, except for benign Rolandic epilepsies and idiopathic generalized, such as juvenile myoclonic or juvenile absence or childhood absence epilepsies. So when you see syndromes, you have something called benign syndromes, which are easy to control. They have no disability, normal MRI, family factors. They remit easily. And these are what we call good. So when I have this patient sitting with, you know, doc, I started one tablet and after that, everything is fine. He's never had another one. Okay, I feel good. This looks like a benign epilepsy. So these are some of the examples of the benign ones. You're aware of childhood, juvenile myoclonic, febrile, neonatal. The angry or the aggressive ones are the symptomatic. There's a scar on the brain. That scar is never going to go. That gliosis on the MRI is never going to leave you. So as long as that scar is there, this child runs the risk of epilepsy long term. Okay, so though he's resistant to medicines, he has multiple seizure types, he has associated mental delay or cerebral palsy, his MRI is abnormal, and he's been having the epilepsy for a long time. These are bad epilepsies. These are difficult. And the day one, I can tell the mother, listen, this one is not going to be easy to manage. You have to have patience with me while I pull you through this phase. Okay, so these are the examples of those. So if you have the word benign, idiopathic, primary, absences, normal development, this has a good feel when you're talking to a parent. And the word encephalopathy, symptomatic, cryptogenic, myoclonics per se are difficult epilepsies, spasms, the child is already delayed, he has continuous discharges, he's a chronic epileptic, you know that you're looking at a difficult epilepsy, which is not going to be easy. Investigation, the sole investigation, two investigations paramount for us is the EEG and the MRI. In the EEG, as I said, pediatric EEG with pediatric interpretation, the pediatric brain is a growing brain, it's a developing brain, so it actually, the EEG picture changes with every year of life, whereas the adult brain after 18 is a fixed brain, so the EEG pattern is fixed. So once you've learned one or two patterns, you know them all. In the pediatric, the patterns are so different that you need to know the evolving picture and is it age appropriate, is it state appropriate, and then you interpret it. Neuroimaging and MRI versus CT we'll cover, but if you're ever thinking of infection, remember to always ask for a contrast. When would you ask for a CT? If you have a focal seizure in a well child, if you come from an endemic region where you're thinking of NCC, where the EEG might showing slowing and a CT scan for contrast is recommended for infective pathologies. It's fast, it's short, it's cheap, it's easy. But other than these few occasions, every other occasion, I would do an MRI. If you have significant cognitive impairment, abnormal neurology, partial onset seizures, abnormal EEG, child less than 1 year, MRI is the preferred modality. For routine epilepsy, you do not need contrast. You just need an regular MRI. If it's difficult epilepsy, you'll ask for an epilepsy protocol where we look very closely at the hippocampus, amygdala, temporal lobe to look for malformations. So now that you've got an understanding of seizure, fit, convulsion, symptomatic, unprovoked, first unprovoked, now you've come to epilepsy and how to investigate that basic epilepsy. And now we're going to come into the treatment of epilepsy. So these are the drugs that we've had from the 1860s, which started with bromide. You can see the exponential increase in newer drugs, which are in the market coming out from 1919 till 2020 at the moment. Okay, so these are the conventional drugs, the bromides, phenobarb, phenytoin, valproate, carbamazepine, benzodiazepines, and ethosuximide, which is now available in our country after a long time. These are the newer drugs, topiramate, lamotrigine, oxcarbazepine, vigabatrin, gabapentin, tiagabin, felbamate, not available in our country, clobazam, fosphenytoin, zonisamide, levetiracetam, pregabalin, rufinamide, not available in our country, rivatracetam, lacosamide, perampanel, and cannabis, cannabidiol, which are now available, again, not available in our country, but there are other forms that we can use for our patients. So these are the main newer AEDs. There are some more which are in the pipeline like fenfluramine, et cetera. And there are other drugs which are not anti-epileptic drugs, but we can use them as anti-epileptics such as pyridoxine, ACTH, prednisolone, hydrocortisone, methylpred, acetazolamide, Diamox, ketogenic diet, and other forms of the ketogenic diet. So you look at the armamentarium that we have to use. These are the basic ones. These are the newer ones. These have to be used only specifically for specific indications. So quickly, just to run through fast because of lack of time, what causes epilepsy? Basically, it's an imbalance of neurotransmitters in the brain. Your GABA is your inhibitory neurotransmitter. Your glutamate is your excitatory neurotransmitter. In the brain, we try to maintain a balance between them. If something happens as a result of which your GABA, actually your glutamate becomes, your excitation goes up because neurons have become more and your glutamate your inhibitory becomes less and your excitation becomes more, you get what is called an epileptic tendency. So these are the end organ that we see on the nerves, on the nerve endings. You know that everything is run by channels. And just to show you that these are different vesicles, these are different channels which open, and all our drugs work on different aspects here. So very important to know that these drugs work on different aspects. So this is voltage-gated sodium channel, phenytoin, carbamazepine, valproate, felbam, adrafinamide, lacosamide, topiramate, oxcarbazepine, sodium channel, levetiracetam, SV2A. Topiramate works here as well as here. Gabapentin works over here, calcium. Felbamate works here. Vigabatrin works on GABA. Okay, benzodiazepines work on GABA. Topiramate works over here on AMPA as well as on sodium as well as on GABA. All your barbiturates work on GABA. So this is just to highlight to you that these are the different channels that we work with. Okay, and that these are the different drugs that work on different channels. I know you can't take it all in. I know it's not easy. Even we take time to go through that. But the important is when you're trying to combine drugs, you will try to find two drugs who work on two different methods so that you can hit the problem with a harder capacity. Another very important for you particularly is the speed of action of the drug. Which are the fast acting drugs? The fastest acting drug today is levetiracetam. That is why it has become so popular in the ICU or in your nursing homes or in your general practice, because one dose of IV levetiracetam or one oral dose of loading dose of levetiracetam can put you into full drug effect and you get the benefit of the drug. As compared to oxcarb, which is from 1 to 20 hours, the next fastest one is valproate from 9 to 16 hours. Remember, you need 6 half-lives before you reach drug levels in your blood, 6 half-lives. So I will need between 36 hours to reach full dose of levetiracetam, and I will read 4-5 days of valproate. But if you go on to those who are slow acting, carbamazepine can go up to 65 hours. So you'll reach effect after you've been on the regular dose for at least a week or two. Lamotrigine takes 36 hours to reach. Phenytoin takes 70 to 140 hours, phenobarbital. That's why it takes almost 10 to 15 days to wash out of your system when you stop it. So when you want fast action, you choose drugs which act fast. When you want slow action, and this is a first seizure, second seizure, I'm not worried. This child is very stable. I can choose a drug which comes into action a little slowly. What is the mode of excretion? That's also important. Not as important as children as it is in adults, simply because we do not have associated blood pressure, diabetes, atherosclerosis, et cetera, which the adult patients have. But knowing how the drug is excreted also helps you to avoid it in those conditions where you have an underlying pathology. So now when we go through these drugs, the first thing you've done when you've had new onset epilepsy, you have confirmed that is a seizure. You were not sure, you waited, a second seizure came, a third seizure came, now you're sure you've got epilepsy. You've confirmed the diagnosis of epilepsy, you did your EEG, you did your MRI, you found that you have epilepsy. You took a very good history, you looked at the EEG and you looked at the MRI and you've decided this is a focal epilepsy because it's coming from one part of the brain because of what happened to this child when he was 3 years of age. And you have in your own little way tried to identify whether this is a syndrome or not. So now when you choose your drug, what are the two things you look at? How effective is the drug and how tolerable is the drug? When you say it's effective means, if I give the drug, how soon will it cut the seizures? And tolerable means, how soon will this patient complain of side effects? So if someone complains of side, many patients come with side effects to a drug, you know that that drug has too many side effects. You're going to stop using it over a period of time. So you need to see how tolerable it is as well as effective. And remember the last line, when two drugs are equally effective, tolerability or the profile of side effects decides which drug you're going to choose. So now I'm quickly going to run through the drugs on a very quick basis with y'all. And the concept is that you just understand, see how many ways it works. It works on multiple. So it's a great broad spectrum anti-epileptic. It's excreted mainly by the kidneys. Half-life is very long. So topamac, any drug which half-life is long can be given as OD dosage. Because if its half-life is long, it stays in your blood system for very long, you can give it as an OD drug. Anyone who has a short life, you have to give it as a BD drug preferably. Half-life is 18 to 24 hours. It's available in tablet only. We don't have sprinkle in our country. Main side effect you need to remember is loss of appetite, weight loss, because it makes you lose your appetite. Second is you might have little speech aphasias which come. And third is that you become very hot. You become hypothermia because you do not sweat, because it works through the acetylcholine inhibitor, esterase inhibitors. and that when topamac is added to valproate, it can make you drowsy. The glaucoma stones are more seen in adults, not so much in children. Dose is 2 to 4 milligrams per kg. You start very slowly if you want to break the side effect of the loss of appetite. It's a broad spectrum drug. Lamotrigine only works through sodium and glutamate, but the best, but very slow acting, again, kidney and liver, kidney mainly conjugates liver. It's available in tablet in 25, 50 and 100 milligrams. When you work it with valproate, it is the best anti-epileptic combination you can ever have of drugs, sodium valproate with lamotrigine. But when you use it in combination, you have to drop your dose of sodium valproate a little bit, add the lamotrigine, and the two are like a magical combination. The only side effect you need to worry about is the rash, which is the Steven Johnson syndrome. It's rare, but it happens. So you titrate very slowly when going up, and you warn every parent and tell them that if you ever see a rash, to go back to you immediately, and you will decide whether this is a drug rash or a viral rash. It's a broad spectrum anti-epileptic, and monitoring not so available. Oxcarbazepine, I'm not talking about carbamazepine. I've gone to its big brother. We usually use only oxcarb now. It has less side effect of carbamazepine. It's liver function, excreted in the kidneys. Half-life is relatively shorter. It's available in tablet and syrup and dispersible tablet also. And it has the same side effects as carbamazepine, which is hyponatremia, leukopenia, and can give you a Steven Johnson rash. Again, please make a note from medical legal point of view on your papers to write, please watch for rash so that tomorrow you don't get caught out on this. And it's ideally only for partial seizures. You will not use, it's not a broad spectrum anti-epileptic. It's only for focal seizures. Vigabatrin is a drug not available in our country, but I have to tell you about it because you can source it if needed. And the one condition is tuberous sclerosis. Tuberous sclerosis comes with ash leaf macule, comes with chagrin patch, and comes with adenoma sebaceum. If you see this, the treatment of choice, it's magical. Vigabatrin, source it, contact somebody. We'll help you how to do it. Very safe, has only one side effect, which is visual field effect, but that's only when you use it for very long on very high doses. Not to worry, it's in tablet form. Clobazam, which is a GABA-mediated drug, long half-life, so can be given once a day. Dose is relatively small. It's maybe the one benzodiazepine that we use the most frequently, and very effective, super drug. So good that we try to use it as a rescue medication. I'll tell you about that later. Side effects are the same as all benzodiazepines. Increased secretion, so they tend to get chest infections. So avoid it in children who have cerebral palsy, etc., because they'll have these frequent chest infections. It causes hyperactivity, behavior issues, and obviously the little bit of sedation. But it does not have tolerance, unlike what you see in adults. Levetiracetam, I think, changed the way we prescribe anti-epileptics. It works on a totally different methodology. It's on the SV2A receptor, as a result of which you can combine it with any other anti-epileptic because no other drug works in the same way. So it's a great combination drug to use. Okay, short half-life, tablets, syrup, and IV. So it's made life easier in the ICU. It's made life easier for children with syrup, and it's made life easier for the tablet for the adults. And now you have an OD preparation also. Side effects are not as little as we think, but mood swings is distinctly something we have. And you can use it for mono and polytherapy and IV preparation, status epilepticus. Rivatricitam is the new one. I'm not going to go into it. It's the big brother of levetiracetam. Main advantage, less side effects and OD preparation. Lacosamide is relatively new. And I know many of you will say, oh God, how are we ever going to prescribe these new drugs? We are not comfortable. Try it sometimes. Try it once. They're very effective with little side effects. Very nice sodium channel drug. Very little side effects. Many of my patients on it been very happy with it. It comes in syrup now, tablet, and even IV, and it's very good in the ICU setup as well. We've been able to stop many status with this as well. So start beginning to become a little familiar with this. This is not available in our country, but just to tell you that it's been passed by the FDA in America and it's used for certain types of epilepsies. It's cannabidiol. It is non-addictive. It is non-dependent. It is not made from the THC part of cannabis, but the CBD part of cannabis, and is used for very specific types of epilepsies. The ketogenic diet is to highlight to you that we use this diet routinely in our patients when we have difficult epilepsy. So we can actually start it from the newborn period when you have epilepsy starting right from birth. And we do it even in adolescents and adults today, because if the seizures are difficult and they're motivated, we use it. So basically it's very high fats, very minimum protein, and even less carbohydrate. It's almost like an Atkins diet, a little more rigid. So we today use the Atkins, or what we call the modified Atkins, or the ketogenic, and we have a large number of difficult epilepsies on it. What's a rescue drug? A rescue drug is clobazam, which you use for intermittent prophylaxis, febrile convulsions, catamenial epilepsies, when children have seizures just before their menses. If your patient has the time to tell you, I'm feeling something, and you have time to put the tablet in and get the benefit of it. Cluster seizures and preventive. What are cluster seizures? A child will have multiple seizures over a period of 1 to 2 days, and then will have nothing for 2 to 3 months. And in that 2 to 3 days, you'll have these multiple seizures, and it also has preventing status. Can we just mute?
Yeah, please go ahead. I'll do the.
Okay, so at this moment, what we have is this is just a quick slide to show you that this was a study between the regular phenobarb, phenytoin, carbamazepine, valproate, and they found there was no difference in efficacy between the drugs. And this is our old drugs, carbamazepine, phenytoin versus lamotrigine versus topiramate versus Oxcar versus, and again, there was no difference between the same, they are as effective. So now I'm trying to tell you that all these drugs I've introduced to you are as effective as each other. These are the salient side effects that are associated with each of the drugs. Even if you can know 2 side effects of every drug, that's all you need to know. The most important one for valproate is weight gain and hair loss. PCOD in adolescent young girls. So you will not use it in an adolescent young girl. You don't want her putting on weight and losing her hair and having excess hirsutism, obesity, menstrual cycle problems, etc. Carbamazepine is diplopia and cognitive with hyponatremia. Phenytoin, we try not to use anymore because it changes the facial structure of the child. Phenobarb, drowsy and cognitive with ataxia. Lamotrigine is only the Steven Johnson. Topiramate, main side effect, weight loss, loss of appetite, and the temperature increase. Levetiracetam, main side effect, mood swings. Vigabatrin, field cuts. Benzodiazepines, drowsiness, tolerance, increased saliva, and hyperactive, makes children hyperactive. We won't go into zonisamide and the other ones, and the ketogenic diet can give you constipation, nausea, vomiting, and rarely calculi. But in our country, another very important aspect is the cost. So we have to look into the cost when we're choosing something. I cannot give a 10 rupee tablet to someone who can't afford it. So we have to look at the cost, and those which are in the red lights are those under price control, including the levetiracetam. So those are more easily given today, and the others are, yes, a little more expensive. So you have to match your drug with your patient's economy, economic status. And you also match whether there is a syrup, a tablet, or injection or not, so that you can match it according to. Child can't swallow a tablet. Crushing the tablet makes no sense. You might as well find something which is a syrup form. So the aim of treatment today is not just to stop the seizures, but to do it with minimum side effects. We've reached that point where you don't just say, I want the seizures to go, doc. You say, I want the seizures to go, and I want my child to continue living a normal life as if nothing was there. This was a lovely study to show you that when they tried one drug, any drug, on the group of patients, 50% of patients responded to the first drug. To that remaining 50% that didn't respond, they gave a second drug. 13% more responded. To a third drug, 1% more responded. Do you understand that once you have failed one drug, 60% of patients will respond to 1 or 2 drugs. 30 to 40% will not respond even if you put them on 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 drugs. So when you have failed 2 drugs, it means you have passed the point of easy treatment. You need to become someone who is referred down the line. Okay, so when you choose your drug, so now I'm telling you that most of these drugs are the same. They're as equally effective with each other. So if they're equally effective, you will look for the seizure type, and you will look for the side effects of the drug, And then you will put those in relation to the person sitting opposite you. So here I have a really thin, skinny 10-year-old girl whose mom is complaining that she's not eating. Doctor, what do I do? She doesn't eat. She's all the time, or she's got anorexia or whatever. I will never choose a drug which makes you lose your appetite. I will put Valproate on her. I will say, maybe she'll gain some appetite. Maybe she'll put on a little weight, and mom and she will both be happy. So you choose your drug depending on the person sitting opposite you with the knowledge at the back of how you want to choose it. So when you start treatment, you start low dose, you go slowly, you reach the maximum dose of one drug before you discard it. Try and use OD or BD preparation, adjust it to the child's activity. Don't wake him at 7 a.m. to shove that teaspoon into his mouth. Okay, so you have to adjust it to the child's activity. You can add a second drug. If you achieve control, try and take off the first drug. The golden rule of treatment is minimum medicines. If any of us had to take these medicines, you will realize what they can do to you. So you want as little medication in your child's system as possible. So you have to keep the seizures as low as possible, and you have to keep the side effects as low as possible. It's a balance you play between the two when you choose your drugs. So first you start with a single drug. If it doesn't work, you try a second single drug. If it doesn't work, you may make a combination of two or your third single drug. If that doesn't work, you can go to another combination of two. Before you go to a third combination of two, you might think of a combination of three. You could think of a second combination of three. And if after two or three drugs, it's not working, it's not going to work. So you have to think of ketogenic, surgical workup, or vagal nerve stimulation. We'll touch on that later. So when you do the rationale, it's seizure type. You're first looking at the seizure. When you're adding the second drug, what you're looking at, is it focal or generalized? Is there an epileptic syndrome? And if so, which drugs are known to work with this? How does this drug, this is a sodium channel, let me add a GABA to this one. This one side effect makes weight gain, let me add something which makes weight loss. This one is interacting with other AEDs, and how is it related to the patient in front of you? So we have guidelines internationally. Every country has made its own guidelines, and we have our own Indian guidelines as well, which we as a group have made. And this is the final consensus of all the guidelines worldwide, how to choose the best drugs for the different types of epilepsies. So for generalized seizures, whether they're GTCs or they're absence or they're myoclonic, sodium valproate is unanimously still the drug of choice. Then comes the topiramate, lamotrigine, levetiracetam, even phenobarb and benzodiazepines. For absent seizure, drug of choice, valproate, ethosuximide, and lamotrigine. For myoclonics, valproate, lamotrigine, topiramate, zonisamide, levetiracetam. Now it doesn't go in this fixed order. You will choose any of these depending on the side effect and the patient in front of you. For partial seizures or focal seizures, it's oxcarbazepine, carbamazepine, and then lamotrigine, topiramate, levetiracetam. So whichever ones are in purple are focal drugs. They work only on focal seizures. The ones which are in this pinkish color are what you call broad spectrum. Like you have broad spectrum antibiotics, you have broad spectrum anti-epileptics. They work on both focals, generalized, myoclonics, atonics, everything. So you choose them accordingly. A P into GTC or partial to generalize is exactly the same. It's basically a partial or a focal seizure. Combinations, the best combination is valproate lamotrigine. Then comes these other combinations which can be tried. A good one is valproate carbamazepine, which you might be more comfortable using. So which are the broad spectrum? Valproate, lamotrigine, levetiracetam, topiramate, and lacosamide, which are the add-on drugs, which you will just add onto one as a quick fix. Clobazam, clonazepam, you can add the ketogenic, B6 works, and acetazolamide. So when you're looking, first you're going to look at the seizure type or the syndrome type. Then you're going to study how effective that drug is. Then you're going to look at the tolerability or the side effects of that drug. Then you're going to see, is there a syrup, a tablet, or an IV preparation, depending on the age of the child sitting across the table. And you're going to keep cost in mind. And all this you're going to do in relation to your patient there. How long do we treat? Seizure-free for a 2-year period, you may consider taking off the AED. You must know your syndromes and then decide accordingly. We tend to do an EEG prior to tapering to see whether it's ready to come off or not. In symptomatic epilepsies, we might actually wait for 4-year seizure-free before we take off the medicine. Okay, but remember, every child, whatever the cause, be it cerebral palsy, be it a syndrome, be it anything, every person, and all this that I've been teaching you today is not specific only for pediatric, it's also specific for adult epilepsy. Everyone warrants a taper trial. You must try and take off the drug sometime or the other. And if they fail once and they get seizures again, you could put it on again. And I honestly will give you at least two trials of taking them off before I tell a patient, your kid needs lifelong treatment or this person needs lifelong treatment. Okay, so when you're on more than two drugs, you taper the maximum benefit drug last, and that mom will be the person to tell you. So who is considered intractable? If you get more than two seizures in a year, for more than 2 years, and failure of more than two drugs, this was the old definition. Now we don't wait for 2 years, two drugs, all those different criteria. We say if you have failed two drugs, it means you are going to be difficult. If you have a focal pathology on the MRI, you need to refer because surgery might be an option. If the EEG is very aggressive and angry, the child is deteriorating, cognition and development is going down in front of your eyes, do not wait. These are the most important years where the brain develops. You will never get this opportunity again. We cannot afford to lose time on a developing brain. Please refer to a specialist immediately. Just to show you, this was a child who on day two started seizing. After that day, his seizures never stopped. He just seized all the time. And you can see the EEG on the right side and you can see the EEG on the left side. He had no milestones. He didn't get head holding. He didn't smile. He didn't do anything. After a few days, his EEG became aggressive and became a hypsarrhythmia. And this was his MRI. He had this cortical malformation out here. We had to wait for 3 months because he was too small for a brain surgery. We waited, and as soon as he touched 3 months, we operated on him. We just disconnected this part of the brain. And today, this is the little child who is actually able to. You can see a slight weakness in his function. He's got cortical visual impairment because of the glasses that he's wearing, but he actually can live a normal life. Epilepsy surgery, so ideal for unihemispheric pathologies. Do not wait too long. There's a new kid on the block, which we are now using called vagal nerve stimulator. It's like a pacemaker that we place in your chest. There's an electric wire, which goes from it onto the vagal nerve, onto your left vagal nerve. And that vagal nerve is connected to a nucleus in the brain, which suppresses epileptic activity. And it's very effective. It's expensive, but it's very effective. So the last thing I want to touch is home management. And that is how, when a child comes in, it is our responsibility as physicians to teach every mother and every parent how to manage the seizures at home so that they don't panic and they don't get anxious. I don't know about your parents, but ours actually say they stay up the whole night watching their children with binocs, or they put those CCTVs in their children's room because they are so scared and anxious. So to do that, teach them how to manage. Put the child on the side. No tongue, and so that the tongue and the froth don't choke. No spoon, finger, shoe, or smelling salts. Loosen the clothes. If after 3 minutes it doesn't stop, you will use drugs to stop it. The route you can use is rectum, buccal, or nasal. At the moment, rectal is not available. Buccal you will have to create, but nasal is available. If it's not stopped in the first try, wait another 3 minutes, try again. If it is not stopped, you will go to the doc. So basically, I think it's the next slide. So this is it. The seizure starts. You do nothing. 75% of seizures last less than a minute and a half. Only 25% of seizures will go beyond a minute and a half. So if you are in that 25%, you will need to monitor. So in 3 minutes, if your seizure doesn't stop, you will take the midazolam spray, which is like this. It's a bottle with a nozzle. You will first open it and you'll do fuss fuss in the air to see that the hole is open and the medicine comes out. Then you put it into the nostril of the child and you'll put it like this. Quickly, you have no time to plan and calculate and weigh him. What is the age of the child? You divide that age into two nostrils. So if he's 4 years old, you'll put 2 and 2. If he's 8 years old, you'll put 4 and 4. If he's 16 years old, you'll put 8 and 8. Very easy. If he's an odd number and he's like 13 years old, you go one up, 14, you'll do 7 and 7. 90% will stop in that. So less than 10% of that 25% will now continue and have another 3 minutes. Again, you wait 3 minutes. If it still doesn't stop, you can do the whole thing a second time. Again, the same doses. if it still doesn't stop, so 97% will stop by this. If you fall into that 1-3% off, you will have to rush the family to the child to the hospital. You cannot do it a third time. It can cause respiratory depression. So when I'm sending my child off, what do I advise? That medication is a must, never to be forgotten. Ideally, it should be at the same time on a daily basis. Don't be rigid. Make it easy for the parent and the child. Find it according to their timetable, just before he's had his after breakfast before going to school and roughly 12 hours later. What precipitates seizures? Lack of sleep, excessive emotions, exhaustion, and infections. Try and keep those in check. Child can do all activities, no restriction on food, outing, discipline. You can scold him, you can make him study, you can let him go for picnics, everything. Only thing to avoid is water bodies alone. If he's with a teacher or the parent is with him or a friend or someone is with him, he can do all this as well. Older children, remember, do not let them lock the bathroom door, because God forbid if they fall down and have a seizure, you have to run in and open the door. And at the time of the menses, it might get worse. This is called catamenial epilepsy, and we can give you medicines to help you there. So this was the spray, and this is basically what I just told you. Put a cushion, loosen clothes, turn to the side, time the seizure. None of this nonsense. Look for an ID. Do not force the child down, because you might fracture his shoulder or something. Once the seizure is over, he will be sleepy for a few hours after that. Tell the parent that is normal, not to panic, and that's fine. And this is what we give them as a seizure chart so that we can monitor the seizures. You can see this is called cluster seizures. This child got a cluster of 2-3 seizures every day for a period of 10 days, not more than that, almost for 1 month, and then got nothing at the end of the day. And when you looked at it and you looked at the chart and the whole year he was clean, this was the day school started, 14th of June, 15th of June was the day school started. And where was this? October. This was the end of the Diwali holiday before school started again. You get it? So then you get an idea as to what's triggering the seizures. Remember, these people have comorbidities. They have cognitive decline, behavior issues, sleep disorders come with it, nutrition and social integration. So it's not just the epilepsy. You have to look at all the other aspects of their development as well. So running and revising again, right drug, a seizure type, efficacy, tolerability, pharmacokinetics, formulation, and cost based on your patient. I don't think we have time for the cases, which are really very simple, but I'll come to the conclusion. And that is, I hope you've at the end of the day understood the difference between a seizure, convulsion, a fit, and epilepsy. These are the events. This is the tendency to have seizures. The classification divides you into seizures and epilepsy are mostly focal or generalized. Understood the concept of what a syndrome is. In the first unprovoked seizure, I explained only need an EEG. No treatment warranted after the first event. More than two unprovoked seizures is called epilepsy, which needs treatment. The most important investigations for us is EEG and neuroimaging, of which MRI without a doubt is better. You need to know something about the drugs which are available in the market. While almost all are equally effective, it's the side effects which will help you choose the drug. This we've already covered. Remember that everything that's new is not always better. So it's not just you who likes sodium valproate and carbamazepine. Even I prefer like sodium valproate a lot. So while I might be using lacosamide, levetiracetam, topiramate, lamotrigine, etc., sodium valproate is still a mainstay of our treatment. So don't feel you have to use the new ones. Remember, they are as good as the old ones, but the new ones usually have less side effects. So you must prescribe as to your own comfort level. When you're doing combinations, think how you are planning your combinations now. Intractability warrants an early reference to a specialist, so you protect brain development. Home management of seizures is a must for all the epilepsy families. And drug monitoring, I didn't have time to go into this, but drug monitoring is not routinely recommended. And with that, I end for the session. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Anita, for an excellent talk. Thank you for stop sharing. Pooja is moderator, so Pooja can pass on the questions, whatever have been asked.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, excellent talk. There are two questions. One is about Gardenal. I didn't understand the question very, very clearly. It is, which one do we recommend Gardenal? So I guess it would be about indications of use of Gardenal.
So Gardenal is an excellent drug. I think very often it has been maligned wrongly. It does not cause all that hyperactivity and behavior issues that is, yes, it does in some patients, but not in all patients. The best indication for Gardenal is two in the newborn period, neonatal seizure, still Gardenal is the drug of choice. And I would say you can comfortably use Gardenal for the first year of life. The next best indication, obviously, Gardenal is in the ICU setup in status epilepticus. So I would say these are the two best indications, but I'll be honest, when I struggle with a patient and has multiple drugs and it's not working, I still sometimes add Gardenal and like magic, everything disappears. So do not throw away a good drug, but yes, the new drugs have less side effects, so you have to choose accordingly.
Okay. Ma'am, the next question was a slightly different question, but is there a relation of cisterna magna with autism spectrum disorder?
It's totally off the topic, but actually no. In short, no. There is no autism spectrum disorders associated with few MRI subtle changes, but there is no clear-cut MRI picture or MRI malformation, which is characteristically associated or synonymous with autism. I would say no.
A question by Dr. Mahmood Merchant. What is the treatment of infantile spasms?
So if I had time, I would have gone through all the specific types of epilepsies, but due to lack of time, I deleted all those slides. The drug of choice, ACTH, to cut a long story short, ACTH is number one. High dose oral steroid, and when I say high dose, I don't mean 2 per kg, I mean 4 per kg of oral steroids. My next drug choice would be vigabatrin, which is Sabril, it's called Sabril. For tuberous sclerosis, it would be my first choice, but for others also, I would use it. Nitrazepam is a very good drug. Topiramate is a very good drug. And zonisamide has been also put to it. Valproate, unfortunately, is what everybody uses. But valproate only works if you use it in very, very large doses. And you're a little worried about putting high dose valproate in a child less than 1 year, because infantile spasms come usually less than 1 year of age.
Ma'am, I'd just like to add to that, that I think infantile spasm is the one seizure that you don't want to sit on. So if any doctor is seeing a child with infantile spasms, please refer or treat immediately. Don't wait for days or weeks for the spasms to just keep increasing, right?
Infantile spasms are associated with neuroregression. They are the most difficult type of seizures for us to control. And the best way to control is to reach them faster. And invariably, we've done ample studies to show that most times infantile spasms are missed. They're missed by doctors, they're missed by parents, they're missed by everybody, because all it is that. That's it. And they say dachakna, chokna, they give you all excuses, but they don't realize that these are seizures.
Okay, I think we don't have any more questions for now. So I'd like to thank Dr. Anaita for an excellent talk. I think we do have a lot of drugs in our armamentarium, but I think one point that ma'am did make, I'd like to reiterate, is be sure that they are seizures before you start anybody with anti-epileptic medications or label them with having epilepsy. Over to Dr. Rasiksha, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Pooja. And thank you, Dr. Anaita Hegde, for an excellent talk. This talk will be available on YouTube channel for anyone who is either late, joined late, or who is not able to view during this time. They can log on later on anytime and it can be viewed. And from next time, we will have on Zoom, participants can log on if they log on before 3:30. After 3:30, the room will be logged, and those who are logging on after 3:30, they can go on to the YouTube. So we have both, pleasure of both. This time today, we had more than 60 people on YouTube and about 13, 14 people on Zoom. So we had about 74, 75, and maximum we have reached in one of the master class was more than 100. So as of now on this particular Zoom, we have a subscription of up to 100, and then we can go on to the YouTube. Next master class is going to be on case discussion by general practitioner, like what we had 2 weeks back. So the part of that is still left. So Dr. Dholakia will be moderating that. He's a family physician. And along with that, we will have not panelists, but some of the doctors who will be asking the questions and answering. Along with them, we will have a panel, expert panel of the consultant from the SRCC Children's Hospital. So next Wednesday, again, it will be the same format. The room will be open at 3:15 p.m. And those who log on before 3:30, they can come on to the Zoom, and after 3:30 on the YouTube. And this can be seen on YouTube anytime later on. So thank you once again. And last word, if any, from Dr. Anita Hegde, and then we will close the room.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And I hope it's helpful to those in their everyday practice.
Thank you, madam.